Hey everyone, buying a car is simple. If you know you want an F-150 pickup, for example, you can go straight to Ford. But buying a graphics card is not simple. Let's say you spend countless hours of research and you finally decided to buy an RTX 470. You then have to decide whether to buy direct from NVIDIA, which is called the Founders Edition variant, or buy one from MSI or ASUS. Or from Zotac, Gigabyte, Palit, and PNY, apparently. Yeah, so it's confusing. Especially when Amazon completely mislabel everything and tells everyone that a white 4070 only supports HDMI compared to the black version that supports both HDMI and DisplayPort. Spoiler alert, every single RTX 470 card on the market supports both monitor connectors. Amazon is just rubbish. So why are AMD and NVIDIA making all of this so confusing? Why are there so many brands? And does the GPU brand ever really matter to consumers? Well, before answering those questions, let me back up for a minute and explain how and why graphics cards get released. So making the specific graphical chips that power GPUs is hard. Not every company can do it, especially because it costs so much money to actually research, design, and manufacture the specific chips. This is really where AMD and NVIDIA can make a lot of money. Here's the thing though, creating some awesome new GPU microarchitecture with 84 RDNA 3 compute units is only half the battle. These chips then need to be sold to us consumers so that we can play Fortnite. I mean, awesome manly games like Sniper Elite 5. Yeah, Fortnite sucks. The process of actually getting a chip onto a consumer grade PCB, a circuit board, and then installing the VRAM, cooling, and everything else, and then selling it to end users is not fun. Firstly, whilst many of us are probably fairly decent human beings, I'm guessing, some consumers suck. They abuse and misuse products, and then they try returning them. NVIDIA and AMD often just don't want the hassle of having to deal with this. Equally, whilst enterprise hardware earns AMD and NVIDIA lots and lots of money, consumer boards like graphics cards have much lower margins. There's more risk there. So it kind of makes sense for the work of turning a GPU chip into a final product to be outsourced. That's where MSI, ASUS, Sapphire, XFX, Palit, and all the rest come in. They are called board partners, and they take specific chips and specifications from AMD and NVIDIA, and then create the final graphics cards to sell. Yes, I know that NVIDIA sells GPUs directly too, calling them Founders Edition, and I'll discuss this point later on in the video, but NVIDIA makes and sells a lot less of these Founder Edition GPUs than they actually sell via their board partners, so I want to focus on that point first. When you look for a specific GPU model like the RTX 4070 from NVIDIA or the RX 7600 XT from AMD, you notice that the specifications have a specific value, like having 5888 CUDA cores or offering 12 gigs of GDDR6X VRAM in NVIDIA's case, or the AMD card that says it has 32 compute units and 16 gigs of VRAM. Well, actually it says maximum, but this is pretty much what you'll get with that specific card model, no matter who you buy it from. If you know they want a certain graphics card model, then all the key specs will be the same. And that's because NVIDIA and AMD will sell the graphical hardware, like the actual chips themselves, to their board partners with minimum board and cooling specs. In other words, all of the different GPU brands out there have to deliver a certain base level of performance for each GPU model. You're certainly not going to get 60 FPS with Sapphire, but only 41 FPS with an XFX card, for example. Now, you might be wondering about graphics cards that says OC in their overly long and confusing product name. OC stands for overclocked, and this is where the board partners actually make the chips run a little bit faster, although this is often just a few percent better performance than the baseline case. The cards don't use special different chips or anything like that. It's mainly just marketing by the board partners, to be honest. There was a time when overclocked graphics cards were worth purchasing, but nowadays AMD and NVIDIA offer loads of automatic boosting technologies, and this is something that their brand partners must deliver as part of the minimum specs that I mentioned earlier. NVIDIA has GPU Boost, for example, which allows the GPU to automatically run faster than the specified base clock speed when it's able to. Basically, as long as the graphics card doesn't get too hot and doesn't draw too much power. In other words, if a GPU was only rated for 200 watts on its TDP rating, then the board partner wouldn't be able to constantly boost the GPU to the extent that it uses 250 watts, for example. But despite everything that I've just said before, don't blindly say, great, I can now go and buy a GPU from any brand and hop onto AliExpress to buy an AMD RX 690 Arc Super. That's totally not photoshopped. There are actually some differences between GPU brands that are worth knowing about. Firstly, if you view the detailed specs for a particular GPU, you might see that they advertise having boost clocks, but that boost clock availability will vary based on several factors, including thermal conditions. Now, I've shortened that quote a little bit, but that's an interesting point. The cooler the graphics card runs, the easier it is for a GPU to hit the frequencies that AMD or NVIDIA specify. That brings us on to the first main difference between GPU brands. The way that a GPU is cooled is one point that can vary a decent amount between all the different graphics card brands. Yes, AMD and NVIDIA do set out minimum specs for the cooling, and this leads to Zotac's RTX 4070 card saying things like advanced cooling and Ice Storm 2.0 discussing how air is 360 degrees. I mean, yeah, that's kind of how most graphics cards are cooled, and that's how air works as well. They have fans on them, and then the fans spin. Cool! But marketing jargon aside, the Zotac card doesn't seem to have anything too unique. Here, commit that to MSI's card, and it does look like more thought has actually gone onto the cooling setup for that specific graphics card model. It discusses having multiple fans that all work together, and also having a copper base plate, as well as various heatsink pipes that you run along the full length of the card to help dissipate all of the heat. This is a few other things about cooling too, and yes, I know that this might just be marketing, but in general, this specific MSI card does have a better cooling system than the Zotac card I just mentioned. So this difference between brands does matter, sort of. We know that cards can automatically boost their performance when thermal conditions allow. In other words, when a GPU is running cooler. So, the fact that some GPU models actually have better cooling setups than others can result in greater performance. That boost is easier to achieve. But let's not get carried away here. AMD and NVIDIA still give specific performance ranges for their cards for each specific model, meaning the one bought partner's GPU can't suddenly be 20% faster than another partner's card, or even NVIDIA's own ones. Yes, the cooling setup matters, especially if you value a quieter gaming PC, but it's not going to lead to 10% or even 5% performance gains. It's often just 1% or 2% difference. The second difference that I wanted to cover, though, does really matter if you have a smaller case like a micro ATX or mini ITX. Some graphics cards have two fans or even just one, making them fairly short and easier to fit inside smaller cases, whereas other cards are full fat and have three fans, meaning that they are longer, a lot longer in some cases. I personally needed to investigate this point a lot when buying my RX 670 XT card, because my old Corsair Carbide 88R case only fits GPUs up to a certain length, and a three fan variant probably wouldn't have fit. So if you're working on a smaller form factor build, then this is a factor that you'll need to look at. Some brand partners just make longer cards due to their cooling setup. The third difference between both partners can also be crucial, and it's the fact that partners themselves handle support, returns, and replacements. Basically, if you have a problem with your GPU and potentially need to RMA it to send it away, then a company's customer service levels is really important here. ASUS, for example, don't really have the best reputation, with many bad reviews all over the internet, and also some big tech channels like Linus Tech Tips actually cutting ties entirely with them when it comes to sponsorship money. This compares to companies like XFX that have a slightly better reputation, and they even used to offer a lifetime warranty for some of their graphics cards, although they did sadly end that program back in 2019. Different companies might also offer different warranty terms too. For example, AMD specify that their GPU should still have 2-year warranties, and this is generally what XFX now offers in the UK, for example. ASUS and Zotac then offer 3-year warranties. However, Zotac sometimes extends this up to 5 years when you register a compatible GPU through their portal. So this is probably the biggest difference between brands of graphics cards. But of course, you should always go out and speak to friends, if you have any, and check reviews to see whether a particular company offers good levels of service too. There's no point of having a super long warranty period if the company makes it really, really difficult to actually RMA a broken card. Before moving on to discussing the NVIDIA's Founder Edition, I wanted to quickly point out two other differences that can exist sometimes between GPU brands and makers. Firstly, the aesthetics will vary between cards, of course. Some have a nice pure white design, others have cool looking fans, some cards are really short, and others are super long. That's one big benefit of NVIDIA and AMD actually farming the GPU delivery out to their partners, because it allows for more customization and competition options in the market, which is great. Finally, some GPU makers offer fairly unique features, like how some ASUS cards actually have a little dual BIOS switch on the back that allows you to run the GPU in a lower power mode, so that it makes a lot less noise than the main performance mode. So that's kind of a cool feature, and it does set ASUS apart a little bit from the other brands. So far I've discussed how ASUS, MSI, Sapphire and all the rest are different to each other, but what about NVIDIA, who sell cards directly to the public, known as Founder Edition cards? Well, firstly, NVIDIA don't actually manufacture these directly in Jensen Huang's oven or something like that. They're still outsourced cards. Foxconn and BYD often have the contract to actually build these reference boards, so it's not like NVIDIA are directly manufacturing them, although they do directly sell them. The main difference between the FE cards and the board partner ones is that the FE ones often look simpler, They're actually fairly nice looking though. They're clean and minimalist, which many of us actually value above sparkly GPUs with flashy looks. Secondly, NVIDIA don't really bother with fancy cooling systems or overclocking their cards. You'll get the base level of performance with the boost technology, but maybe not the extra 1 or 2% of performance the some board partners manage to squeeze out of their overclocked cards. Of course, there's nothing actually stopping you from removing NVIDIA's own cooler, switching to liquid cooling, and then overclocking the card in GeForce Experience. That's actually why some people buy Founders Edition cards in the first place, because they don't want all the extra cruft that the partners add in. They just want to buy direct from NVIDIA and customize it. In short, there was sort of a time when the brand of GPU mattered, but nowadays, due to things like automatic boosts and minimum specifications from NVIDIA and AMD, the main differences now come down to some extras like the cooling systems and also the warranty terms. And that wraps up this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please click the thumbs up button and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.